receiver pair is only sensitive with some certain with a very narrow certain range, which means it's perfect to work as a transmitter receiver pair, because you won't like you would not like to receive some other, you know, unwanted signal. So this is the emitter part. As you can see, this is emitter is literally a infrared LED. LED is a dial. So this is the symbol of the dial. And this positive negative. And for our mouse, and most likely for the full size mouse, most people use 5 volts to power the emitter system. And some people, other than this part, this is like simple 5 volts emitter, zero resistor to limit the current, then usually people just connect to ground on this terminal without having this. And this will make the basic functionality for the mouse, for the emitter to send out the infrared signal. However, by using this way, you will not be able to send like really high current. And there's a spec on the infrared LED called maximal forward current. Well, if you ever learn EE tube EE tube, because the micro junction, right? It's like forward, reverse current voltage. In order to not damage the dial, there's a spec on forward current. Means if like keep this on constantly, you should not exceed that value. So typically a typical infrared LED has like about 100 milliamp current. If it's fine for close range, because a lot of people just like keep constant on, make sure the current's only 100 milliamp, and it can read. It's not really far, and the problem is it's noisy, and the other problem is there's no way we can turn it off when we want it off. That's the problem. So I'm gonna explain why. I'm gonna explain later why we want to turn it off sometimes. But for this schematic, you will see there's I put a MOSFET, okay, after the resistor, and this it has a logic gate plus power amplification. Usually it doesn't have to be MOSFET. It can be either bipolar transistor or MOSFET. And for this case, it doesn't matter which one you use. You can even use Darlington transistor. Darlington transistor, which is two MOSFET, two MOSFET, kind of stack each other, which works as you can simplify the model of Darlington transistor as a single ampere transistor. For this case, they literally work the same. Alright, on your Kim mouse, of course, I use the MOSFET. This MOSFET can go up to 1.5 amp current, which is totally safe for this setup. And you see there's the resistance I'm zero with, it's only 10 ohms. So assume this is the ideal model, and when it's fully turned on and the current goes through, there's no resistance on the MOSFET at all. And then the voltage drop out for the dial is 1.5 volts, let's say that. So can anyone give me a simple calculation how much current is going to go through when this turn on? If it's 5 volts, if this drops 1.5 volts, and the limit, the current limiting resistor is 10 ohms.
Can anyone take out your calculator? Do some simple calculation.
How much current is there?
350 milliamps.
250? That's close. Yep. So 5.
So do you know how to calculate the current go through this sensor?
The voltage divided by the resistance.
Well, there's this dial the voltage drop. So if you want to calculate the current go through entire scale, you have to use the supply voltage and subtract the voltage drop out on the dial first.
Which is 3.5 volts up,
then remaining voltage divided by the resistor value, which is ideally 350 milliamp. So compared to 350 milliamp, see it on the data sheet of this typical sensor. The one we're using is SFH. Charge and discharge. Right? This, so the receiver, right? Receiver essentially is flower receiver is transistor, it's a phototransistor, so it's a transistor. Transistor takes time to charge and discharge, right? Before you can easy to read the maximal stable value, you should have to wait before you know,
happening.
It just matters how much is happening. So, as a matter of fact, for the two standard diagnostic pair, it does, but it's acceptable. If we can make the positive separator, it's definitely preferred. But the thing is, the charging and discharging time for the sensor takes kind of too long. It's definite affordable to make all four sensors, you know, turn on and off individually. It's fine. But before this setting, I made a dynamo sensor zero to charge in order to save the pausing time. Because the sensor we're using is FFH4545 plus TFT4300, and I purposely make the receiver insensitive, because insensitive makes more, takes long time to charge and discharge. The reason I make it insensitive because it's good against noise, because you know it's not that responsive with things, you know, sudden change. Safer for me, however you treat off the time. So this is for the echo sensor. And then, no, I think this is a mistake. This should be, the resistor value should be less in order to make it thicker. So the one we're using is 2.5. upstairs. And the two diagonal sensors are serial together, so there's only one control, right? One pin control, and left front sensor, one pin, right front sensor, one pin control to turn on. Let's say this is left front sensor. This transistor lock is a left front sensor. Transistor and the right front sensor. So this emitter signal, well, because when you turn it on, they keep it for a certain time to make a receiver fully charged to turn off, right? Emitter is like ideal digital signal, that's why it's a regular shape. For receiver, it takes time to charge.
And from beginning to end.
So this time is the minimum time needed in order to read the maximum reading value for the receiver. And this time will be determined experimentally. So what that has is receiver connect to the oscilloscope over there, and just try the different turning on time, see what's the minimum time you can, you know, fully charge until you get satisfied DC level in order to fully turn on. That's what I get. And in this case, the minimum I got is about 60 microseconds. And for safety, you can either use 80 or 100 microseconds to make sure it's fully turned on. But actually, on the same time, it makes 60. So, that's also the time you use for your function. That's why it's called trigger function. Also, this is called just charging time. Okay. We know the reason why we care about the charging time, but why we care about this charging time? For the receiver with the same sensor, you don't care about this charging. But like I said, when you're sending the infrared signal from one emitter, it will somehow bond it through the wall and being picked up by another receiver. So in the meantime, you're reading the ADC. The other receiver might also be charged with it. So in order you start the next session of the pausing the second emitter, you have to wait the second receiver to complete this charge first. Otherwise, then part of your reading will be from the first emitter. Right? So you wait here to get rid of the residuals. So timing for charging is also determined experimentally. For our case, it's about 80 microseconds is a minimum. And discharging time varies with the distance of the wall, because when your sensor is closer to the wall, you know, because your reading will be higher, right? So it takes longer to charge the maximum. Further than work, you know, it only pick a little signal, it only charge a little bit, so it takes less time to charge. So in order to determine the worst case for this and this, I test with a really close wall range in order to find the worst case, and so far it works fine. It's like 60 microseconds, 80 microseconds. Okay. So do you guys get this while we are pausing them? Any questions?
I have a question about the emitter circuit. Like, what do the capacitor?
Oh, this one, right?
Yeah.
Well, remember, even though we're pausing this at how much current? Okay, previous one, how much current? 350 milliamp, right? It's really high. You're pausing such a high current in a really short time, right? We'll drag down the body supply. In order to have a very stable power supply for the air cell, so these capacitors located in the photon cycle line is a large value, is as the bank to store the, you know, because I'm purposely put this capacitor really, really close to this emitter. So it's whatever, just in case there's any like instant current shortage, you know, charge shortage, because they use a lot in a short time, this one will supply this. It's called a bypass capacitor. Because you always have a large capacitor, really close with the components. You don't want to
run it too much.
Yeah, smaller, right? Small one is kind of for low pass filter. Because whenever you have like, you know, have like pausing, right? The because it's supplied by certain constraint volts. When the gyro is not spinning, the LC is half of the voltage by default, which is almost 65 volts. So when gyro turns spin to the right, the VLC, the voltage output will be smaller than 1.65. When spin to the left, the voltage output will be greater than 1.65. So we record the standard voltage when the gyro is not spinning, right? We record it as a reference. So whenever we spin the gyro, we use the output, subtract the one standard one we record before, right? As a raw output.
You're not using a comparator between the ref and IC?
Well, I used to use this, but this one is not that reliable, so I just record the VREF by myself. Because the gyro only outputs the angular velocity, right? So each time you make a sample, you record the LZ, then subtract the LZ, you know, you pre-record it when the gyro is not spinning, subtract it as a raw angular velocity output. That's the data we're using. However, it's not yet perfect. If you're just doing this, then you have to use more, you know, software way to deal with it, which is what I'm going to show next slide. Well, as a matter of fact, we know gyro drifts, right? Have every guy heard the term drifting for the gyro? Okay. Well, the reason gyro drifts is because the value you recorded when gyro is not spinning is not okay. It's 12 bits, right? It's integer. It's just not accurate enough, and it just any arbitrary value, you know, because your gyro reading is not stable. It's changing all the time. It's kind of bounding, like up and down around the standard value. And when a gyro is not spinning, what is the raw out outputting once you use LZ minus the value you record before? What's the value of that? What's the raw angular velocity when the gyro is not spinning?
Zero,
right? Why? Because this output minus the one we recorded, they're theoretically same. So once you subtract them, it becomes zero. So at the moment of zero is zero. However, the value you recorded when it's not spinning is not perfect. So when you keep subtract them and accumulate them for angle, you will find that it's being getting off and off and off from the center, even though it's not spinning. Right? That's called a zero-point drift. That's why we're trying to find a way to fix it. And I'm trying to record this a lot of that is in terms of time, in a long time. We'll figure out, okay, even though it's drifting, but the trend for long term is linear. So we will be able to figure out the pattern that sum of each subsample includes a lot of information. So okay, for this equation, right? I can simplify the equation. So whenever you read ABC, use a Y to record it, then because the Y is the sum of 50,000 samples, then you do about 50,000. It's the category information. But the reason I prefer this way is that this way because your ABC reading is an integer. You don't have any flow points afterwards, so it's not accurate enough. That's why you should keep the number as large as possible before you get final value. That's why. And that's why I amplify it first, subtract the Y you recorded and run for yourself. Because the Y you recorded for the for the total angle includes 50,000 of ABC readings, which includes a lot of information. So you don't want to divide by 50,000 at the very beginning to lose information. That's the reason I use this equation instead. That's why if you go check your recent read gyro function, we'll be able to see a really large number here as a line. If you can check your function, you should go check. So, you guys understand why I'm doing this?
What is the why?
Why is the overall. Okay, it's the why is the ABC reading for the loss? Okay, for angle, actually, for angle. Because you are accumulating each.
So for 1,000 samples, why is the total like accumulated?
It's how much you drifted for 1,000 samples. For 1,000 samples, it's how much you drifted, right? That's why you should go check your function for your gyro reading function to get connection. You will not be understanding. I only recognize it. I only make it either the slides or the function. Do that for how it works together. Yeah.
So why is it constant though?
Why is it constant?
But it's determined empirically.
Yes. Yeah. Right. You have to test it.
Right.
You have to lost here. Like,
just leave it sitting there for 50 seconds.
Yeah. 50 seconds. Yeah.
Could you not do this every time you turn up, like have to run for 2 seconds, or is that not accurate enough?
Yeah, but the thing is, when you start this loss of maze, the maze might shake, might vibrate, based on when you accidentally touch it, hit a maze or something, it will cause such a big disaster for a lot of concentration loss. And you will make 50,000 samples definitely, because there's much more information than 2 seconds, which is about 2,000 samples.
And the variation from startup to startup is not large enough for it to be significant.
2,000 is good enough for general purpose use.
Okay.
This just 50,000 more samples is statistically more reliable, convincing.
Right. But those are samples that you made in a lab condition as opposed to in the field, like there's humidity and stuff like that.
I think it's just only temperature.
It's temperature.
Yeah. And I think by doing this one's good enough because I mean there's definitely a lot of better ways to calculate the gyro drift, but I think this one's the easiest and most cost effective. There are definitely better ways like software filter for solder, filter is just long keep using the function we provided on the chain. A lot of things, but for our case, I think it's mostly affected by temperature. For our case, it's fine, because the gyro is not next to any like, you know, heating components, so it's fine.
So what is the internal mechanism for a gyro to sense a...
Gyro? Okay, it's a gyro accelerometer, this kind of microchip. Results, you just use the chip as the way it is. Yeah, the way they make the gyro is definitely due to commercial secret. You're not supposed to know, man. That's how they make money. Okay, this is buzzer. Remember, when you say buzzer, we're not using piezo, because buzzer has polarities, and where piezo doesn't, and the configuration for piezo is way different with buzzer. So, try doing your own mouse, don't use piezo. Plus, piezo is not loud enough. Alright, so buzzer? Yeah, buzzer has a polarity, has a positive and negative phase. So this is optional, okay? So assume this doesn't exist. That's 3.2 volts for buzzer, a positive and negative gold transistor, and ground. Then the MOSFET, here, just turning on and off periodically, because we use the square wave to drive the buzzer with different frequencies. The dial here is because the buzzer itself, I'm saying the reason called the buzzer is because it's a magnetic buzzer. It's essentially inside is an inductor. So because the induction has, because you're sending like alternative sending like high low signals, and you know the characteristic for inductor is when we have an AC, you know, kind of almost like AC, you know, or high frequency signals go through this component, it will generate a kickback. So the purpose for the dial here is preventing the kickback current to damage the component itself and any other components shared with this stream point feedback. You see some lazy schematic doesn't even have the protection. Okay, this is like, remember we have the full character of numeric display. You know, it's just like for your point of view, you just like walk components like this, and it's powered by 5 volts, and the logic level is 3.2 volts, even though it's powered by 5.5 volts, but it's compatible with 3.2 volts logic. And as you can see, I put like 0.1 and 10 microfarad capacitor to, you know, stabilize the power supply. But I think I'll experimentally, I don't need just 10 microfarad. Actually, I don't need any capacitor to make it work. But the whole capacitor here is for safety caution. And you need 4 pins to at least to make it work. Data in and cop are 2 typical pins for the SPI bus, where the cop and cop the data is sending, serial off the data stream. The RS and C are digital pins. RS refers to register select, and C means chip handle. And how exactly make it work, you have to go check your data sheet to refresh the timing, how it works, because it's really hard to explain, you know, how the display works by just only showing this schematic. You have to read your data sheet to and associate with the function overview to figure out what's the auto turn on and off which some people is like even using 10K. Okay, what's the beer? Why do we mention? Because we want to keep the battery safe. Because battery fully charges. Okay, for 2.0 batteries, fully charged 8.4 volts, even though it's indicated by 7.4. And when the battery is low, it's about 7 volts. So we're trying to not make the battery low, battery lower than 7 volts. However, we don't have a protection circuit for the battery. That's why we have to use software to monitor the voltage periodically to keep it safe. That's why we have screen. When we provide a function called a low battery, it will warn you when the battery is lower than 7 volts. So you should try to utilize the battery, that function. That's why, before you can make your mouse search, we will provide you a large 1000 mAh battery with a protection circuit from a smartphone. So one reason is that battery lasts longer. The other reason is the battery will power off whenever it's lower than 7 volts. So you at least have no trouble to worry about this.
Where does that voltmeter pin go?
AC battery. This is a voltage divider.
Okay. So
B battery ground.
Voltage battery.
Yeah, because the maximum ADC, the maximum ADC level you can read on the microcontroller is 3.3 volts. So that's what we said. So we should make sure it's as high, the reading is as high as possible, but not oversaturated. It's 3.3 volts. The maximum you can read here is like 2.7 volts. Most people just ignore the importance of the power supply. However, it's very important. Well, we have two battery jacks and one power switch here. You already know. This is a 5 volts power regulator. And as I mentioned, we need some high, really large battery capacitor to stabilize the power supply, right? That's why we have a 100 microfarad. We also see a 0.1 microfarad capacitor as noise filtering because most of the noise are from the motor. Because the motor is V battery directly, right? So you have the V battery shared with the motor power supply. So motor draws also occur. So it generates most of the pollution. The pollution comes from this way to the power unit. If you don't have this sort of protection, your output here will be unstable, most likely. Yeah.
Well, is that switching or linear regulator? This one here.
Oh, the one we are using are all low dropout linear regulator. Because it's compared to switch regulator, linear regulator is efficiency is low, however, it's very stable. So we're jumping from the battery to 5 volts. It generates heat, but we're okay with that because it's not that hot. Because you know, motor takes most of the power, not the 5 volts regulator. So this is the extension of the power supply system. You already see this input output. That's why I also put 0.5 volts microfarad. Because a lot of people, you know, a lot of components share in 5 volts power supply, and the noise could be from one component, you know, which is pollution, noise pollution, I see for your kit mouse, you see like yellow capacitor. Yellow one is the tantalum capacitor. So when you design your mouse, maybe you're using 100 microfarad, consider you use tantalum capacitor for better performance. Of course, I mean, ceramic works, it's just how much you care about design. But actually, power indicators on 5 volts. You need power. You remember you should put a power indicator because David and Jeremy's for their first, because they're taking 184D, then their first Micromouse, they forgot to put this. So they first powered on, they have no idea if it's on or not. Put on it, it's really useful. It's required for cables. Remember the emitter? Infrared emitter is 5 volts, right? I think it's, other than water, the emitter takes most of the power because the current is UV, right? Makes sense. Okay, 3.5 volts, what kind of component is 3.5 volts? Microcontroller, right? 3.5 volts? And
gyroscope.
All the analog devices is 3.5 volts? And a button? 3.5 volts, flash drive?
The emitter collector, or the emitter sensor pairs?
Yeah, that's all analog device.
Yeah.
Okay, that's it. It doesn't consume that much power. That's why the 3.5 circuit regulator right here is only using 400 milliamp current version as a maximum. Compared to 5 volts regulated, we can go up to 1 amp. That's why I only use 400 milliamp. That's why the chip can be much smaller. Those are the input. You've already seen this before. It's output. The regulator itself requires the reduction resistor, so to put it the way it is. So for the output, you see a larger capacitor, 0.1 microfarad. the larger one is only 10 microfarad compared to 100 microfarad because power usage is 3.5 volts, much lower than 5 volts, of course. So this digital 3.3 volts, and you see the inductor here. Zero is 3.3 volts, and output. As the analog stream, analog 3.3 volts up, analog 3.3 volts power supply. Because, for the character of the conductor, it holds the AC. Okay, inductor, as we were in high school, it holds the stop AC, right? To let AC go through. So, the read over here is. As the putting duct here has an energy storage device. So whatever it is, fluctuation. But some other device will use 3.3 volts, which is pollution. If there's pollution, go through here, the inductor will like stabilize the power supply. Even though we already have low pass filter here, but it's an actual protection because AC analog power supply is more sensitive. Much more precaution on the analog power supply. And of course, the analog rod, the splitter here, it's just a physical junction. So I don't need, we finish the schematic, I don't need a splitter, but for the ego, once you connect these two, you will not be able to connect different things with the two networks. For instance, this is ground, right? A different symbol and name G and D. This is a different symbol with that ground and names are different too. H G and D. So once you this ground, this analog ground, once you connect them, either this one becomes ground or that one becomes analog ground. You can only have one edge. That's a problem. That's why I have to make a splitter here. So I'm drawing a chase on these. I'll be able to know, okay, this chase is analog ground. Don't merge with digital ground as until you make all of them go back to battery. So yeah.
And how did you tune or how did you figure out what the value of the inductor should be?
Well, that's a good question. Usually the inductor value, the larger the battery. The larger the battery to filter out the analog signal, the AC signal.
Right.
However, the larger inductor means the longer the coil is. Is the longer that the larger resistance is. If the resistance is too large, it will jump too much voltage. 3.5 volts same inductance for the inductor. They have different package. Usually the larger size, the less resistance. That's why when you're buying the inductor, you should check the data sheet. What's the equivalence resistance? Usually as low as possible.
Is that a cordless or a cord?
It's not. It's just regular inductor. It should not be. It should be cord.
With a chariot or something.
Okay, it's not the reason. Have every guys heard the components called the ferrobits?
Yeah.
You did. Ferrobits is something you see exact same symbol with inductor because somehow you have some characteristics which really really similar to inductor. However, it's not same thing because whenever you have a AC signal go through, the inductor holds the AC power, AC current, and it releases slowly, right? Where the ferrobit, it just literally converts the AC noise to heat. So, and also, ferrobit is more responsible with very, very high AC noise. Like, people like to use DSP or high speed circuit, they use ferrobit instead because you know, it's more responsive. However, flower case, you know, flower like AC noise frequency level, it's not as high as you can reach like as a DSP level. That's why I said inductors prefer instead of ferrobit because if ferrobit doesn't just don't help. If noise is not within the range of the ferrobit literally works like a wire. Okay, I think that's it for today. Any question? Any question for my definition? These are all you need to know for the hardware. You know, the other two probably run the mouse and then design your own circuit. To know how it works. Like for power regulator, it's not even an option, of course. While you're looking for your own voltage regulator, there's one thing you should notice is, first is you know, the maximum current you can support. The other one is the voltage dropout. Usually find the voltage dropout, you should find the lower the better. This one I find is pretty good, it's pretty low. The 3.2 voltage regulator, has a really, really low voltage dropout. That's why the reason I use it. Because 5 volts regulator usually be, it's always been really hot because sensor pulsing takes a lot of power. So you should put more efforts on this to try and find which other device you want. And you should at least be more experimental. Okay, this thing takes about, the data sheet said it takes about 20 milliamp, but for our case, I only set this at 30% of the brightness, so I tested the current consumption is definitely under 10 milliamp. However, the area under this screen is always warm, so when you design your own mouse, try to make a thermal hologram and use this LED display. And the buzzer, you need to check the loudness for the buzzer, the receiver, the resistor goes through zero waves. The larger the resistor goes zero waves, the larger AC reading you'll get. Because equivalently, you consider this as a resistor. So whenever you have a light go through the resistors, so this is literally a voltage divided. So you're only reading part of the voltage. And the higher the voltage, the higher the resistance of this larger resistor, the higher value you're going to receive for the AC. However, not higher the better, because the higher you put here, the faster it's going to rise and charge and discharge, because the voltage on these two terminals are reduced. So you have fast response time for the receiver, that's good. However, it's much more noisy. So this is not, I believe this is better than the past. It's the best resistor value for the receiver, because there's some other people who use the same receiver but use different resistor values. But this is like what I've decided experimentally. So when you're testing your own sensor, you have to test your own values. My friend is like even like 1K, gives a really, really high value. And charge like much faster. Like 20 microseconds compared to like 60 microseconds. However, I believe it's much more noisier. So I don't know, you need to test that. I didn't test it. Okay, so emitter. The one we're using here is the 915 nanometer wavelength version emitter. And there are also options with 850 nanometer wavelength emitters. So SFH4555 is definitely not the only option. And like SFH4550, which is I think the best option on the market for as of the 850 nanometer wavelength emitter. You can also use that, but that one has much smaller beam angle. And you have to find a receiver with 850 nanometers wavelength as well. The other two matching emitter. Okay, that's it, that's for today.